When my friend, Brad Thor, when he like thinks about writing a book, what happens is the thought becomes a bestseller. And then the book follows, and then that's just how it works. Everything he touches, it turns into gold. Brad, it's so good to see you, my friend. It's been a long time.
It has been, Dana. You have got a fabulous set there. I'll tell you, next time I'm on with you, I'm going to set myself up in the gun barn, and we can all compare what we got on the walls.
There you go. Right. Let's do that. You have a gun barn? A whole barn of guns? I'm so jealous.
I needed a lot of space.
Instead of like a he said or a she shed. Yeah, he shed, she shed, have a gun barn. I love this. Congrats, by the way, on your latest book. And by the way, folks, you can go to bradthor.com. Near Dark is the latest bestseller from you. And I want to get into it. I want to talk about it here. I have not read this one yet. My family is a huge, I think I've told you this before, huge fans of everything that you do. And it doesn't matter what I do. I'm a dork. You're the cool person, and I'm a little cooler because I know you. But I wanted, because of your background, and you worked with Department of Homeland Security, you have a law and order background yourself, I've got to get your thoughts on this new national normal of law and order. And Minneapolis police, they have a 10% drop in their force. They're missing 100 officers. And then out of all the things to happen after their defunding was voted upon by the Minneapolis City Council members are now demanding that police do more. But I don't know that anyone, Brad, would be prevailed upon to do more considering everything that they see and how cops are treated in the press. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, I agree with you. It is a very difficult time to be a police officer. And I've got to imagine it's really tough to recruit in this environment. We ask cops to do a lot. There's such a misconception in the general public with what police officers should and shouldn't do. You know, there are people that think cops should get shot at and should take a bullet. The cop's number one job is to go home alive to their family at the end of their shift. You know, if I see one more time in the mainstream media, oh, it was a routine traffic stop. There is no such thing as a routine traffic stop. Every single traffic stop could be the one where the driver or a passenger pulls a gun and starts shooting at you as a police officer. So we've got a real disconnect between what the police do and what the public thinks they do. You know, this idea that, oh, you should just shoot them to wound them. There is no such thing as shoot to wound. There's shoot to stop the threat.
Yeah. Doesn't that open I would think that opens them up to a whole new room of liability by parsing it out like that. Just shoot to wound or shoot to maim. That's why it's not taught that way too.
Right. Exactly. It's definitely, I went through the police academy in Illinois. It's not taught that way. You're taught the continuum of force, the appropriate force to administer based on what the threat is, and then you shoot to stop. So if you're in court and the judge asks you as a police officer, all right, why did you shoot this person four times? Because it took four shots to stop that person. Mm-hmm. They refused to stop, and I shot four times. So it's a difficult time. We're all under so much stress with the pandemic and everything else going on. We're really kind of coming apart at the seams. And what hurts me as an American is there's so much more that unites us than divides right. us. But we really lack national voices on both sides, particularly because it is an election year, trying to pull us together. It would be so wonderful to see Republican and Democratic leadership saying, listen, we can work on this stuff together, a national message of unity. But we're not getting that from either side of the aisle.
Well, I think that sometimes I feel as though, especially back in the Tea Party days, I feel because when that started and it was just as much as a check on Republicans as it was calling out the left, because I remember I was out in the street protesting before the election, before Barack Obama was elected.
I never went to a rally until I was doing Tea Party stuff. And granted, that was in response. My participation was in response to Rick Santelli's rant.
Yes.
And the whole idea that, you know, this huge yes. portion of our economy was going to be taken over by the government. And I remember holding up signs that said, don't spread my wealth, spread my work ethic.
Right.
My father was a United States Marine, joined the Marines to get out of the South Side of Chicago and get the GI Bill to go to college. I mean, second generation American. My grandfather was the first one born here. So America offers great opportunity. Is it perfect? No, it's not perfect. But this is the greatest system of government ever put together in the greatest nation in the history of the world. And there's always room for improvement. But we hurt ourselves if we pretend it's the worst nation in the history of the world, which it just isn't.
It absolutely isn't. I totally agree with you on that. And that's it, this idea attacking, you know, things like whether it's the founders or what I've been talking about on air. And I've been seeing this. I was actually talking a little bit earlier about just not just the school board meeting in my area, but I've seen this story crop up in states all over the country where, you know, curriculums introduced that leading you to question the legitimacy of America's founding because the founders were flawed. And so, ergo decido, if the founders are flawed, then the logic dictates that the country is illegitimate and the founding is inconsequential. So everything is just a joke. And, you know, we know that isn't true because that's, first off, that just betrays the whole ethos of what it of Americana. I mean, we believe in redemption, we love the underdog, and we love a great comeback story. And if there's all three of those things, which by the way feature in your books, all three of those things, that's just essential to Americanism.
It's so true. And you look at what Dr. Martin Luther King said he wanted for all Americans was a fulfillment of the promise made by the founders and the founding documents right. and the founding of this nation. Fulfill that promise for all Americans. We should not be saying that that promise is somehow flawed because of the founders. Even Dr. Martin Luther King said this is a great promise. This is something that we want made available to everyone. That's where the focus should be, not going back and burning down from the beginning. Right. You know, I look at what happened in Louisville, where they went after that Cuban restaurant owner when they're passing out those mafia-like demands of
extortion.
Give up your sales revenue. It's extortion, exactly. It's crazy. But we live in such fearful times, like the French Revolution. These nuts can't get people to the guillotine fast enough. So there are a lot of people with voices that are afraid to speak out because it's not – there is no more free exchange of ideas right. in the public square. It's I have to destroy you because I disagree with your ideas and then make sure you lose your career, you can't work anymore, mm-hmm. your family – I mean, my God, the Taylor Swift fans went after a music critic. I mean, people have lost their minds. They doxed her because she said some things about Taylor Swift's new album.
Yeah.
And that
and
all
it wasn't
this
mean.
Stuff is in the bloodstream now, and it's bonkers.
Exactly. We have been so polarized that we think that we have to treat everything that way. I see some bits. I see some pushback. You know, I've seen, whether it's people like J.K. Rowling or Ricky Gervais, I've seen instances where I have a little hope. Is that enough, though? And is what some of the examples that we see, like Trader Joe's pushback against cancel culture, is that going to be enough? Is that enough of a spark? Because we are in a new revolution, which is separate from the war, a war of independence, obviously. But is that enough to stop or at least reset the way that we have been viewing everything? Is it going to stop the canceling, stop the tribalism, or is it just too late?
Well, I think cancel culture works only if you allow yourself to be canceled, right? I mean, we saw this. It's happened with going after advertisers for shows and all that kind of stuff. I look at Terry Crews, who is tough enough to stand up and say, I'm not going to submit to this. This becomes a form of fascism in and of itself when you're not allowed to possess different ideas. And somehow he's saying, I want to reach out to all people, whether they be black, they be white, they be brown. I'm happy to be with all people of good conscience and to talk about these ideas. And yeah, I'm willing to die on this hill. It's going to take many more strong, confident voices to push back on this. Right. But this is a difficult time within which to push back on something like that because everybody's so fearful. To ask people to summon courage at a time where we've got such terrible unemployment and people's businesses are going under, it's a hard time to ask people to be courageous, but it's oftentimes at the most difficult points in our history that we need to come together and we need to summon that courage.
To summon the courage and to have grace towards other people and not immediately assign Amen. The worst misinterpretation of something to what they've said. And that's what that Amen. I can't stand either. And the absence of any kind of redemption, which betrays the whole point of why do you care so much and why are you so passionate to be out here advocating for XYZ issue if ultimately, you know, you just want to destroy the person that's disagreeing with you, if it isn't about even so much as persuading them. And I think it's so sad. That's where we are. I want to talk. I want to save a couple of minutes to talk about your books. And I have to say, you and I have known each other. We've known each other for years, and we've been through some crazy times. Especially when we lost a dear friend of ours. That was very. It was my first Los Angeles funeral. It was my first Los Angeles funeral experience, which is very different from something that happens in Southern Missouri, right, where everything is very quiet and very, you know, very somber, and there's a lot of baked and fried goods. And the point that I'm making by bringing this up is that we have always, I think we see people as people and issues as issues. but largely in popular culture, I think that's been conflated. And now we can't separate people from issues. And so if someone has an issue with an issue, they take it out on that person. And it's so much easier to look at an individual and remove from them their humanity and go at them as though they're just, you know, a box to check or an issue to debate and conquer, et cetera. And maybe that fuels some of it, because you and I don't even see eye to eye on everything. But I always look, you know, I have my friends first. I mean, I always look, you know, the people who I've been, who have been my friends, and, you know, the people who, you know, you've had experiences with and you've known for so many years, that that relationship is so much greater than any disagreement that anybody could have. And I just wish that more of the country adopted something like that.
Yeah, I agree 100%. Kindness can only be expected from the strong. And a lot of this cancel culture and this teardown that you see is not coming from a position of strength, it's coming from a position of fear. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, like I said, people are really stressed out now. It doesn't mean that cancel culture wasn't ramping up before coronavirus, but I think now everything's turbocharged.
The fuses
so
are
kindness
shorter.
And patience are what my watchwords are. I'm trying to cut everybody extra slack. It's not, you got to leave the fight completely, but I think now more than ever, you need to embrace the
just
people who disagree with you even more.
Yeah, just be graceful. Just be gracious about it, for sure. Okay, so you've written approximately 11,000 books, all of which have been bestsellers. Every one of them a bestseller. So your latest book, Near Dark, which congratulations, by the way, this follows Scott Harvath. And I'm not even going to pretend to be able to pronounce the Norwegian ally. I love this story, though, because I love the relationship that is developed in the description. Like I said, I have not read this book. I'm excited because I do love your work and I have read your books. Not repeatedly, like certain members of my family. I have not read, like, you know, some of your books 3 and 4 times. You have an ability to take an area of knowledge that is very far removed from the average American, their knowledge base and skill set, and really make it a very compelling thriller and really put people right in there, and they really do understand it. And you make that world real and accessible for them. Tell me about Near Dark.
So I tell people, this is my recurring hero, Scott Harvath, mm-hmm. and my books are like the James Bond movies.
Yes.
You don't need to have ever seen another James Bond movie to go right out and see the new one.
Scott's like the original John Wick, kind of, right? I think Scott Harvath is
a
like the,
bit, yeah.
yeah, I think so, the it original.
Is, and what's funny is, particularly in this book, that's very apropos, because if Near Dark was a movie and we had a poster, it would say $100 million bounty has just been placed on the head of America's top spy. And that's the jumping off point. So John Wick couldn't be a more appropriate call out.
Yeah, no, your guy is a BA. He's very, very much so. That's why I'm like immediately thinking he's the original. As always, congratulations. Near Dark is the book.
Thank
and you can go to bradthor.com/book. Near Dark is right up there. bradthor.com. And you can follow him on Twitter @BradThor. Brad, always so good to see you. Let's not make it so long before we come together on air again. Let's talk more soon as well. And congrats on the book. I look forward to reading it. So thank you.